Hi there, everyone, and welcome to the second live stream on Simon Says. It's a Sunday morning today here, 10 o'clock in Auckland, and really excited to have the second live stream and to chat with you all a little about starting your own smart home. So I'm not sure what stage you are all at, but I thought it'd be a really good idea just to have a look at the planning stages of a smart home and some of the things that you might want to consider before starting your smart home. So personally for me, I went straight in. I basically didn't plan anything. I just went in and started playing around. And for me, that was pretty cool. I love fiddling with electronics and playing around with stuff. So that was really awesome. But for a lot of other people, you might be going in with the expectation of having a system that's going to be up and running and perfect right from the set go. So I thought today it'd be great to just have a little bit of a look and see what are the planning stages and some of the considerations about smart home. So in 2024, we've got so many different options that are being pushed at us about smart homes. So we've got things like Apple, obviously, with their home smart kit stuff. That seems a lot of people seem to be moving on that. We've got things like the Amazon Alexa. And excuse me if I'm setting off your Alexas out there. We've got the Google Homes. And then we've got all sorts of other different types of kits. So that's one of the first starting things is about what you actually want to run on. But before we discuss that, and welcome everyone, I see we've got people coming on board the live stream. Great to have you here today. Please feel free, make any comments. I'd love to be able to answer any questions that you've got about starting your smart home devices, integrating them, whatever you've got. Please feel free, fire up your questions in the chat there. I can't promise I will be able to answer them. I'm not an electronics expert or a computer programming expert, but I'm a real fan of home automation. So let's have a chat about these things and feel free to ask questions as we go. First thing we're going to do is having a look at planning the smart home and talking about What are your goals and objectives of starting a smart home? And some of the things that I was thinking about were, first of all, simplifying of daily tasks. So you might, for example, want to be able to walk into a certain room and the light turns on instead of having to turn it on using a switch. Second thing might be cutting down on power bills. Don't know about you guys, but everything seems to be going up at the moment. Inflation is crazy, and smart home devices can definitely be used to make sure that you are saving money on your power bill. And some of the ways you can do that are, for example, if you're running an air conditioner or a heating system in a certain room, someone opens the window, well, that's immediately going to reduce the performance of that device, isn't it? So in that case, really good idea to be able to set up an automation in your home assistant or whatever you're using to be able to effectively control that device. Either have a warning, you could have text-to-speech coming out of one of your devices saying to people, please turn off the heating system if you're opening the window or something like that. The next thing you might want to have a look at is security. So obviously a lot of people like to use cameras outside their houses to record information and to also trigger things based on that. So those are three reasons that you may want to start a smart home. And what we'll do as we progress through today, we will start discussing further how you're going to implement those. Secondly, it's having a look at your budget. So when it comes to smart home devices, they are certainly getting a lot cheaper than what they used to. And there's some really great devices available now, especially with things like the new two-year integration on Home Assistant, that you can use really cost-effective devices and implement them in. The only thing is, of course, with the two-year system, you are limiting yourself by being working with a cloud-based device. So that always has its challenges of if the device manufacturer makes some changes to the cloud, it can fall over. So yeah, always good for me personally, if possible, to have everything locally on my smart home. But it's not all that always that easy, and often you need to start doing workarounds. For example, I've got a really cool integration that is working with one of my favorite actually smart home devices. If I was thinking about it earlier, is my outdoor weather station. It's a simple Wi-Fi based weather station. It's transmitting the information from the weather station using 433 megahertz across to the little display unit. The display unit is then pushing up via Wi-Fi signal, connecting to my router, and then going up to the cloud. And then I'm doing an integration with Home Assistant to pull that data in. Now, I ideally want to try and get a radio-based system that I can actually sniff that signal and read the information locally. Because I find every time Home Assistant is updated, I'm sitting with a problem that it is falling over and I no longer have any information coming out there. So that's an interesting one. Now, next up, talking about the cost of a smart home. When you're deciding which sort of a hub to go for, that can often affect the cost of the smart home. For example, if you're using the Apple system, you are limited devices that are HomeKit certified. And those are often a lot more expensive than some of the other devices that you could perhaps integrate with other systems. Yes, you can put a bridge onto your HomeKit and integrate it that way, but it's obviously a little bit more complex. So that's one consideration around cost. There are a huge amount of really cost-effective devices available now, and you can find these on websites like Amazon and AliExpress. Personally, for me, I find AliExpress is actually really good. A lot of people are fearful of ordering things off AliExpress, especially technology-based devices. For me personally, I find AliExpress to be really, really good. One of the things that they do is when you order an item, yes, you pay up front, but the seller only receives the money once you click the little button to say that it has actually arrived and that you're happy that the product is in good order. So I would certainly recommend AliExpress as one of the places to get really cost-effective home automation devices. And I will certainly be posting up devices that I've found, and feel free to try them out for yourselves. Now, when it comes to the different ecosystems, personally for me, currently I'm using Home Assistant as my main system, but there are some other systems that I'm using in conjunction with Home Assistant. So I have taken my Apple HomeKit. I have one of those small home hubs, Home Hub Mini, and I have connected that to Home Assistant. And that's one of the ways that, for example, if you don't want to either pay for Nabucasa or to actually get a remote coming into your system via the old SSL certificates and things like that, HomeKit is a free way of accessing the sensors that you're using in Home Assistant. You can access them via HomeKit. It's all set up. You don't have to pay anything. It's a free interaction. So let's talk about hubs. Now, for me, I started off really basically. I started off with some Wi-Fi color bulbs in the ceiling, started playing with those with the app. I found that really interesting to learn about devices. So learning how to actually install the light or the switch, learning how to actually get it working with my mobile device, with the app. And I very quickly saw that the limitation was that I couldn't effectively control multiple devices from different providers on the same app. So yes, you can have all these different devices, Philips Hue, you know, the Tuya devices and all these different devices, but each one of them is going to have their own app. And that's going to mean you have to switch apps, and also they won't communicate with each other. So very quickly, I found I needed another device. So I went along and I bought the really basic Amazon Alexa. Once again, really cost effective. You can pick them up when they're on special for about $25. And that was pretty cool because I do see that a lot of the devices that are being sold are available integrated into the Amazon Alexa network. So yes, it is a really cool way of being able to actually start off with a basic, really cheap device, no electronics knowledge required to set it up. You can just buy it from the store, plug it in, and it will connect to a whole lot of your devices. Now, the next level up, if you're looking at the Amazon devices, is to go for one of the Show devices. I use the Amazon Show 5. It's one of the older ones, and it's really cheap as well. I picked it up for $75. And that one was actually going for a, as I say, I picked it up on a special. And once I had that up and running, yes, I could actually control the devices via voice. I could actually even go into the screen on the device and actually start controlling my smart home devices. The problem was the response was dreadfully slow. Honestly, as far as I'm concerned, not acceptable at all. I wouldn't be willing to use that as my controller for my smart home. You do have the Amazon Alexa app that you can use. And yes, that is a lot faster, but Echo Show 5, it's good for some things, but certainly not for controlling things from the actual screen. I have noticed recently that the Alexa has actually, well, Amazon has released a new tablet device that you can install on the wall. That's come out in the last day or so. And I see a whole lot of videos talking about that. And certainly it seems that they've improved the performance, the actual scrolling performance, the clicking of the buttons looks way better. So that is well worth having a look at if you're wanting to stay on a really basic system like the Amazon system. So yeah, worth playing around. Give one of those a try. I'm not sure of the price of those. I haven't actually seen them locally advertised as yet. But yeah, worth having a look at, worth giving a try to. Welcome everyone on the screen today. Please feel free, make comments if you'd like to. It's always great to hear what your questions are about how you've started your smart home and what you're using your smart home for at the moment. All right. So once you've chosen your device, your Google Home, Alexa, Apple HomeKit, Home Assistant, Homey, there's all sorts of other ones that you can choose. Personally, for me, I was playing with these different things and I came across Home Assistant. I did a huge amount of research. I watched a lot of videos and basically decided that I would give it a go. I had an old Raspberry Pi lying around that I had bought a long time ago. It was a Pi 3B Plus, I think it was. And I basically downloaded the software onto the memory card, stuck it in, fired it up, and I was quite amazed to see this actually popping up and showing the Home Assistant system. I very quickly got it up and running, and there are some videos that I've created showing you how to do that. It's quite easy. You don't need major skills. However, Home Assistant has now released a couple of their own pre-flash devices. The latest one that's come about or been released is the Home Assistant Green. There are some links in my videos. It is really, really an easy way to get started. I think it sells for $100. I'm not sure about the shipping, but $100, really cheap way to get a Home Assistant device that you can plug into the wall and you'll be up and running immediately. So that is definitely worth a try. Next up, moving along here, is having a look at which type of components do you want to start with. Now, once you've chosen your hub, the next thing that I would say is well worth having a look at is your network connectivity, especially if you're going to be installing a lot of Wi-Fi devices. So I had the old router that comes, or router. I always find people complaining about my pronunciation of that. Router, router, whatever you prefer. I had the normal one that you get for free from your internet provider. And what I found was that device, I started connecting Wi-Fi bulbs in the ceiling, and all of a sudden, other devices started falling off the network. It was just really weird. So I actually phoned my internet provider, and they told me, well, the router that you're using is actually only capable of handling, I think it was around 20 or 30 devices at a max. And once that is, once you've gone over the limit, they are not offering any support because the router that they provided, that's the limitation. So I actually did go, so there were, at that time, this was about 2 years ago, there were a lot of different routers available that you could buy and mesh networks. However, they were super expensive. Like I'm talking $300, $400, $500, $600 to get yourself a router that was actually going to offer 100 or 200 concurrent Wi-Fi devices that you could link to it. So I did actually go onto, well, I was searching on the internet and I came across this really cheap one. It was literally around $100. And at the time, I thought it'd be a great option. I ordered it and it came on. Now, I just want to read this quickly. I've got a message here from Adam. Adam, thank you so much for coming on board the stream today. And thank you for commenting. So you've installed 3-device mesh Wi-Fi network a while ago and never looked back. Covers the entire house. Replaced our ISP supplied router. Just make sure the settings were correct. Now, Adam, this is the next point that I was going to get to because I had exactly that problem. I ordered this device from Amazon, turned up, installed it, and it wouldn't connect to my ISP. So I phoned the ISP. I thought, well, no, let me tell you something first. I actually phoned the ISP before I ordered this router, and I asked them to confirm, will this work with my system in New Zealand? I'm ordering it from the USA. Is it going to work? They were yes. By the time it arrived and I plugged it in, wouldn't work. So I phoned them up and I said, what's the problem? Spoke to your guy. He said it would work. Plugged it in. Let me grab some water. Now, plugged it in. And this time, the person told me, no, this router will not work with your ISP that you're linked to. So I was really upset, but they weren't interested in doing anything. So what I actually ended up doing is I'm using the router that was provided by the ISP. So that is connecting into my fiber as usual. What I then did was I plugged this new 200 concurrent connection Wi-Fi device that I bought, which is a Wi-Fi 6 based system. It's got really cool options and functions on it. All I did was I went with the Cat 5 cable from the old router into the new one and it worked. So my devices were now connecting to the Wi-Fi on the new router, and the other router, I went into the settings and I turned off the Wi-Fi on that one. So really important to make sure that you don't have two Wi-Fi devices operating together close by. So yeah, certainly using a 3-device mesh Wi-Fi, I'm not sure how big your network or how big your house is, Adam, and what the wall structure is of in your house. In New Zealand, we have timber frame houses, and this means that you've got plasterboard between your internal walls. So the Wi-Fi signals actually travel really well. If I was back in South Africa, limitations in South Africa, solid brick walls and masonry does not allow for the quick transmission of a Wi-Fi signal. So be interesting to get your feedback, Adam, on the size of your house and where you've placed those mesh devices. And the other thing, another question I've got about mesh devices. Okay, there we go. 2-story typical New Zealand timber frame, brick and tile. Awesome, Adam. So you're based in New Zealand. Excellent. Always awesome to have local New Zealand people. I'm based in Auckland. Where are you based, Adam? Be great to get your feedback there. Yes, New Zealand timber frame, 2-story house. Now, the question I've got, I actually haven't run a mesh system as yet. Is your mesh system... So the individual routers, are they communicating with each other via Wi-Fi, or have you got a hardwired connection to each of those devices? I see that you get both options. It'd be interesting to know how that works. My understanding is when you've got a device that is connecting via Wi-Fi between the different mesh networks, you're actually cutting down on the speed of the connection, because it's having to communicate back and forth via Wi-Fi and then back and forth with the devices. So, yeah, haven't tried mesh as yet, Currently, the place that I'm living with is quite small, about 100 square meters or 1,000 square foot as over in the USA. So quite a small place. I've got my router in the middle of the house and seems to be working perfectly. Communicates to all my devices without any issues. Adam's in Auckland too. Awesome, mate. Great to have a local person on the stream. Happy to link up. Yep, that would be awesome. I'd love to meet up. Really keen. It's great to communicate via this online, but nothing beats a one-on-one connection. So let me know when you're ready for a coffee. That would be awesome, Adam. Happy to link up. They are Xiaomi mesh routers. One times next to the fiber, okay? Second is wired to the opposite of side of the house, ran a Cat 5 cable, and third is upstairs on Wi-Fi only. Awesome, Adam. So that's really interesting. So you've actually got both systems running. You've got two of them connected via cable and running via Wi-Fi. It'd be really interesting to know, Adam, do you find that if you run a internet speed test, do you find that the one that is running or connecting via Wi-Fi to the base unit, do you find that the speed is slower on that one than the ones that are connected directly to the internet? I'm not sure if you can tell when you actually access your device, whether it is which one of those different mesh routers it's connecting to, or whether you just, you know, that you're connecting to the network. So that would be interesting. Definitely speed is slightly slow. There we go. So pretty interesting to see that. Yeah. If possible, you need to try and connect all of those mesh network routers via your actual hard wire. Often that can be quite tricky if you've got a double story house to be actually able to cable that to the upper levels of the house to get that connection. So yeah, I totally agree, Adam, that using the mesh network is a great idea. And also obviously depends on how much reliance you have got on Wi-Fi components in your smart home network. Just out of interest, Adam, are you running Home Assistant? And do you have any other type of hubs that you're running with it? Are you running HomeKit or any other types of hubs? Because I'm always interested to know. So for me, I've got Home Assistant running. I've got HomeKit running. When it comes to the communication protocol, so we've been talking a lot about Wi-Fi this morning. And obviously, you've got Wi-Fi devices that are locally connected. So one of the early devices that I actually hooked up was the Shelly devices. I really like the Shelly devices. They are small Wi-Fi connected switches that are local. Although I must admit that I ran a little test the other day where I was believing that my Shelly was completely local and independent of the network, and I unplugged my internet connection and they wouldn't work. Whereas my Miros smart LED lamp was working perfectly, connecting. So that's a really interesting. I don't know if anyone's been playing with Shelly much and what your experiences are, but yeah, that's the experience that I had with Shelly, that for some reason or other, when I unplugged the internet, it wouldn't work. I'm going to do some more tests on that, but if anyone's got any ideas why that is happening, please let me know. So I was led to believe that Shelly was completely local. So yeah, that Shelly is obviously working on a Wi-Fi system. Now, getting back to which type of devices you're going to hook up. So when it comes to smart home devices, for me, first it was lighting. Next, originally I did have the smart home speakers, the Alexa ones, so voice assistants. Talking about voice, I'm really excited to try the Home Assistant local voice control. Personally, I have used the Amazon. It was reasonably good, but I don't really like having to go up to the cloud every time. So I'm going to be ordering one of those new devices soon that is being used for the Home Assistant. I think they're calling it can't remember. Anyway, local control, voice control over Home Assistant. I've played a little bit with it. I haven't actually got a device working. I did order that tiny little M5 stack device. to try and get that working. For me, I couldn't get it working for some reason. I was able to load the software, connect it up, but it was not actually working. So I have tested the local voice with Home Assistant. I've tested it using the microphone on my computer, and it did work. Obviously, it's slower than using a Amazon Alexa or something like that, but I'm really excited to try it. So what I'm going to be ordering soon, I see that they're available now. It often happens that people launch stuff and all of a sudden it's sold out in a matter of hours or days. I don't know if you've seen that little screen. It's a little screen about this size. It's got a display and it's got an ESP32 running in the background. And this is now apparently really cool for running the local voice control. Okay, so Adam is running Home Assistant on Raspberry Pi 3B Plus, wired to the Ethernet. Yep. That is one of the things I would have liked to be able to run Home Assistant via Wi-Fi if I needed to. Now, obviously, it's going to slow it down a bit, but they don't offer an option for it to be run via Wi-Fi. So it does have to plug directly into your router. Sonoff Zigbee USB. Yep. I've had great experiences with the Sonoffs. I've run a couple of them and they've always been bulletproof. And Philips Hue Hub. Ah, that's interesting. So you're using Philips Hue Hub as well as the Zigbee USB dongle. That's interesting. I do like the Philips Hue stuff. It is expensive. I did a video a while ago for Philips Outdoor Hue Lighting. A friend of mine bought the kit, spent quite a lot of money, but he is really happy. That was about a year and a half ago. No issues with it at all. They're running outdoors in the rain. We have lots of rain here in New Zealand. So Philips Hue is great. Two Chromecast. Okay, so are you actually pushing, you're controlling your Chromecast via Home Assistant? Be interesting to see what the how that works for you. Two Google Nest. Okay, so you're running Google and as well, starting to install more Zigbee bulbs and switches devices. Excellent. Now, when you're running Zigbee, Adam, are you running ZHA, so the standard Zigbee communication protocol, or have you tried Zigbee to MQTT? A lot of people are talking about Zigbee to MQTT. I haven't tried it as yet. I will be loading it up soon, and I'll give you guys my feedback on how it works. It does look like there's quite a lot involved in setting up, but I'm really keen to try it because of the fact that it does offer some additional features. All right, Tom, welcome on board, Tom. Great to have you with us here today. Home Assistant on Raspberry Pi 4 runs fine on Wi-Fi use only. That's very interesting, Tom. So you're actually connecting your Home Assistant via Wi-Fi to the network. Please share with me how you've done that, because I actually wanted to do that. The only way that I could do it was I used one of those Wi-Fi extender plugs. So I plugged the Raspberry Pi into the Cat 5 plug on the Wi-Fi mesh extender. And obviously I had the extender plugged in on the other side. So I'd really be keen to hear how you've done that, Tom. Where about are you from as well, Tom? Be great to hear. Adam, I had ZHA but had issues right away. Zigbee to MQTT works perfectly. Awesome. Well, that is one of my plans. I'll be working on that in the next couple of weeks, installing Zigbee to MQTT. I am running Home Assistant currently on Home Assistant Yellow as my main system. Now, I'm actually planning to install a secondary system because I'm always testing different devices and things. I want to actually connect a secondary set up a secondary Home Assistant instance. So I'm going to set that up on my Raspberry Pi 4 using an SSD. I find that that works really well, replacing the SD. So yeah, really keen to, that's very interesting. Tom is saying that it's just a normal Wi-Fi connection to Unify. He's in Tasmania. Awesome. Welcome on board. It's awesome to have run, or Tasman. Is that Tasman in... Tasman, is that Tasman in New Zealand? Well, if it is, awesome. I was actually down in the Tasman. I was in Nelson recently. What a beautiful part of the world, Tom. NZ, awesome. Absolutely beautiful part. I had some amazing trips up north from Nelson to see some of the Tasman National stuff. That is great. Awesome to have local people on the stream here today. Very exciting to meet New Zealand-based Home Assistant users. What would be really cool, I don't know how you guys feel, but at some stage it'd be great to have a meetup. I'm based in Auckland, so I'd probably be in Auckland for a start, but it would be really awesome. Let me know if you're keen for us to set up a meetup. What we could do perhaps, I noticed that they have some little meeting rooms that you can use at the McDonald's. Maybe we should tee up a meetup in New Zealand for the local New Zealand guys, and we can get together, have a bit of a coffee and a bit of a chat, and maybe a bit of a smart home appliance or device swap as well. I've got heaps of devices that I'm not using at the moment, and it'd be actually quite cool to do a bit of a meetup and a swap of devices so that we can share experiences like what Tom's doing. I'm really interested, Tom, if you can send me some information on how to connect my Raspberry Pi Home Assistant via Wi-Fi, because that's something I haven't been able to do. All right. So getting back to what we were discussing there. So networking and connectivity, we've pretty much covered. Smart speakers. Yes, as I say, really keen to try this local control with Home Assistant. I see Home Assistant's actually got a competition on the go at the moment. They are putting out prizes there, Home Assistant yellow, Home Assistant green, all sorts of cool stuff. If you actually create a unique device using the local voice. So yeah, check that out. I'll leave a description below to the competition, but if you're playing around with that stuff, why not submit your system to that competition? All right. So moving on from smart speakers and voice assistants. Oh, smart speakers. Just one thing on smart speakers. Not sure what smart speakers you guys are using. Personally, I've got obviously my Amazon devices as smart speakers. I've got my my Apple HomeKit Home Hub Mini. Quality on that one is really good, I must admit. And then I've got a S30. It's a Bose speaker. It's quite a cool Bose speaker. And there is an integration with that into Home Assistant. The only thing is that for some reason or other, I'm not really seeming to be able to actually stream or to push music out from Home Assistant to the Bose S30. I think that Bose, I know the S30, I think, is a discontinued device, which is unfortunate. But for some reason or other, I don't seem to be able to push music directly. So I can play music on it, but I don't seem to be able to trigger a music stream from either local files stored on my Home Assistant network or from streaming, for example, the radio stations that are available in Home Assistant for streaming. Now, just an update on my live stream. So this is my second live stream. I'm doing this currently through directly through YouTube Studio. I am going to start working for my next couple of streams on actually doing a OBS stream, where I will actually be able to switch into Home Assistant and I can actually start playing with my Home Assistant on the live stream. So just to let you know, that's one of the future things that's coming soon. The other thing is I'm teeing up with another Home Assistant podcast or YouTuber from America. And what we're going to be doing in that is a live setup of Home Assistant. So that's going to be really cool. He's just getting things sorted out on his side. Awesome. So Adam is also an OBS fan. Well, Adam, yeah, I was just amazed when I came across OBS, a free system that you can use to stream video content. It's just amazing. Anyone out there, download OBS, give it a bash. So yeah, my next stream, hopefully I'm going to be using OBS. Forgive me if there's any technical issues, but I'm going to actually use OBS to actually control my stream, which will allow me to actually have that integration. And I can show screens and I can show different camera angles and all sorts of stuff. So that will be awesome. Smart speakers. If you guys are using smart speakers, let me know which ones they are. If anyone has able to actually stream information to Bose devices, or stream media to both devices, please let me know how you did it. Okay. Smart thermostats. So, yeah. So here in New Zealand, we don't really have central heating like they do in Europe and America and things like that. So for a long time, I didn't really have any use for thermostats. However, I've recently installed a Panasonic heat pump into my house, and there's a really cool Panasonic integration into Home Assistant, and it is via the cloud, forgive me, but it does actually work very, very well. I've had no issues with it. It controls my heat pump. What's really cool is you can set up automations. One of the things you can do, recently I got the Home Assistant running on my Apple CarPlay in the car. And one of the things that I really like is at the moment, it's still pretty warm in here in New Zealand. And I get home, I get a lot of Western sun in my lounge, and it's baking when I get home. So what I've actually been doing is using the button on my HomeKit or my Apple device in the car, using the button on the Apple CarPlay to actually, as I get into my car to leave home, which is about 20 to 30 minutes, I press the Home Assistant button and it turns on my heat pump and cools down my house. So when I get home, it's nice and cool. So that is a really cool little, all right. So here we go. Tom is saying HA settings, system network, configure network interfaces, change to wireless LAN tab and configure the Wi-Fi drop down. Brilliant stuff, Tom. I will do that. I'm going to set that up because I'm running this Raspberry Pi 5 on my, which is going to be my test environment. So I'm going to set up a whole new Home Assistant system on the Raspberry Pi 4, not a 5, and see. It'd be interesting. I don't know if anyone's tried Raspberry Pi 5 yet to run your Home Assistant. It'd be quite interesting to hear. I see that it has been released now. I saw a post here on February the 8th. Apparently, you can download the software now for the Pi 5. So it'd be worth finding out. So yeah, that's something I'm going to do on my my backup system. I'll install it on my Raspberry Pi 4, and I will try this Wi-Fi system. Not yet, but might pick one up if I can't find one. Adam, let's just go back. OBS, Adam, ZHA. Might pick one up. Just trying to check what you're going to be picking up there. Adam, pick one up if I can find one. Let me know what it is, Adam. Sorry, I'm trying to read back what you're referring to. Raspberry Pi 3. Oh, Raspberry Pi 5. Okay, yeah. Yes, so Raspberry Pi 5, not sure if they're available in the stores yet. It'd be really cool. If you do get one, Adam, please give me some feedback on once you've loaded it up. So feedback from you guys, what are you all running? So Adam is running his on Raspberry Pi 3 at the moment, which is great. I think it's incredible that Raspberry Pi 3, which was launched how many years ago? Must be 4 or 5 years or more. You can still run Home Assistant on a Raspberry Pi 3. Things I like about Raspberry is, first of all, I love Raspberry Pi, the story of, you know, this guy in the UK coming up with this idea 10 years ago to launch this single board, tiny little computer that was available for $35 at the time. Now, it is really unfortunate that they're not available at that price anymore. But yes, there are some other knockoff type single board computers. Once again, the question is, how well is Home Assistant going to run? And how much sort of knowledge do you need to get it running properly? I do like the idea of running my Home Assistant on a NUC, for example. However, for me, I'm not a network technician or expert, and it seems to me like there's still quite a lot of fiddling around when you're running it on a NUC to be actually able to get it to work properly and to run all your add-ons successfully. So I'm a big fan of running it on Raspberry Pi. It's designed for Raspberry Pi. It works really well. I've got the Home Assistant Yellow, so I've got one of those SSD sticks that plugs into it, and that's giving me a huge amount of storage. I've had no fallovers, nothing. It's a wild, It's wild what they can do. The Raspberry Pi 3 is something like 2016.
Whoa.
So there we go, 8 years ago. I've had that for a long time. Moving to a NUC would mean swapping to Docker installation for HA, which has pros and cons.
Yes, totally, Adam. That is the question. So I was chatting to my brother in Seattle a few days ago. He is working for Oracle and obviously is a developer and all sorts of things. He has a huge amount of knowledge about using these devices, and he's going to do it. So I'm going to get his feedback. But personally, for me, I'm happy with Raspberry Pi. Yes, it's not as fast. And literally, when we talk about speed, it's not talking about speed that the actual Home Assistant runs at. So you press a button and there's a delay. Home Assistant, especially if it's local control, is really fast. The only time the speed seems to really matter is, first of all, when you're rebooting Home Assistant. And secondly, it might be when you start having live camera feeds. So currently, all the camera feeds that I've got running are, there seems to be a 10-second delay. So I'm using a RioLink camera and I've got a Ring camera doorbell. So it seems to be a 10-second delay, which is interesting. The first time I ran my RioLink camera on Home Assistant about 2 years ago, there wasn't a delay. It seemed to be live streaming. Now there's this delay. So not sure when that actually was introduced, but quite interesting. So yeah, I agree, Adam. For me personally, I'm going to stick with Home Assistant running on the Raspberry Pi. I've got it on the Command Module 4, which is part of Home Assistant Yellow, and I'm just going to keep using it there. But I will be setting up a second session for testing. So smart thermostats, yeah, that's been covered. That smart lighting. Now, with smart lighting, there's always the question about whether you're going to replace the bulbs with controllable bulbs, or whether you're going to use a switch, something like a Shelly or something like that in the switch. Now, personally for me, I've gone with Shelly's. Reason I've gone with Shelly's is that they are certified for use in New Zealand on the New Zealand electrical system. So they are, they've got a test certificate, and once you've had them installed by your electrician, you're going to have no issues. And that's really important. When I'm installing devices behind the wall, I want to know that they are certified for use in New Zealand. Other thing I like about Shelly's, the new version of Shelly has a temperature sensor built into the switch, and it has a cutoff. So the moment it overheats, it will automatically cut off. So I feel really safe. All right. Thanks, Tom, for your comment. Fun. Most recently, fun discovery is a Plotty graph card. Swaps out the pleasantries of mini graph for specific style chart. Pleasantries. Okay. Sorry. It was covered by the little heart there. Okay. Mostly a Plotty graph card. That's interesting, Tom. Plotty graph card. Is that a card that you download via Hex, I'm assuming? Sounds like a really great idea. I'm with you, Tom. I really love graphs, and I'm going to try that out. So those graphs on the Plotty graph system, are those available to plot graphs just directly with data from Home Assistant, or do you need to install an extra database for that? That'd be interesting to see. I will have a look at them, and once I've got them up and running, I'll create a video on that Plotty graph. Seems to me people really like videos. I recently released a video all about my top five blueprints. That did really well. So I'm going to be doing more and more videos like that. Let's see what else we've got here. Tom, from Tom, currently greater getting my ESP home running off a Sonoff TX Ultimate and then to bulbs. Currently getting by with ESP of home running a Sonoff. Ah, okay. Yes. So Sonoff devices are pretty cool. I believe that the Sonoff switch was one of the first IoT devices that was sort of released quite a long time ago on sort of these smart switches that you can install behind your light switches. And I got the first one. I've played around with it a bit. They are really cheap, and
good on Sonoff for introducing their devices so early in the game. So I'm assuming you've flashed ESP Home onto that Sonoff device. So that's quite an interesting process. I've done a bit of flashing of devices, and I managed to blow off up a Sonoff in his panel, which was pretty upsetting for me. So yeah, flashing, I'm quite comfortable flashing cheap little devices like ESP32s. When it comes to the more expensive devices, I am a little bit wary about flashing, but yeah, it's something that I want to do more of. I quite enjoy flashing. I've flashed a lot of devices with ESP Home, especially the little development boards, and I've had a lot of fun with that. I have also flashed Tasmota. Tasmota is something that is sort of a lot of people have forgotten about, but it's actually really cool. I've also flashed WLED, and that was really fun as well. So flashing is pretty cool. Another one from Adam here. I have ESP Home soil moisture sensors for the wife's houseplants. Super interesting to see how this hot weather is affecting watering. Oh, Adam, I'm with you 100%. I've actually got two indoor pot plants at the moment, and both of them are being monitored by sensors. And as you say, it is quite fascinating. I've got a little alert. I've got an automation that basically says the moment it goes below 20% moisture, it sends me an alert on my iPhone telling me to water the plants. That is honestly a really, really cool little automation. And yes, it's fascinating to see how, because in New Zealand, it's normally super humid. Today, I think it's 97% or something. Well, it's raining. But yeah, it's actually been quite dry. So I've seen it down as low as 45% humidity, which is incredibly dry for New Zealand. And yeah, it's interesting how that affects your pot plants indoor and how quickly they dry out. Yes, I've actually built an ESP Home-based one as well using the capacitive sensor. I've created a video, and that was a lot of fun. The only frustration I had was that I had to have each one next to a PowerPoint. So what I'd be interested to know, Adam, is have you managed to get that running off a battery? Because the ESP32 dev boards are pretty power hungry. And because they're commuting via Wi-Fi all the time, they would just chew up a battery in a matter of a couple of hours or a day. So one of the things that I would really like to be able to do is start doing some sleep mode management on the ESP32 devices so that you can actually create battery powered devices. So please let me know if you've managed to do that. All right. Well, comments are coming in fast and furious. From Tom, Hex Home Assistant data uses the Plotty JS engine equals Zigbee phone autocorrect. Awesome, Tom. Well, that's great. So I will be installing Plotty after we finish with this live stream and playing around with it. Please let me know, guys, if you've got any other cool Hex or Bluetooth, blueprints or anything cool that I should try out, and I will be doing videos on those in the future. Adam, I flashed Arlec Grid Connect bulbs with Tasmota, turned off the reset button stupidly. Now I have lost them due to a Wi-Fi change I made. Oh no, Adam. Yeah, I had the same problem with, where is it? I've got some of these Atom smart home plugs. And yes, the problem I've got with these, they were set up to my Wi-Fi network of my previous house. And I have not been able to reset them and get them connected to the local network. Now, the problem with Wi-Fi plugs, these sort of ones are sealed up with glue. So very hard to actually go in and hard flash these. You have to hope that you've got your reset button available. I know, otherwise. So Arlec, it's an interesting one. Arlec Grid Connect, I had a few lying around. Well, I'd actually given away a whole lot because the old two integration I really did not like, and I got rid of all my two devices, gave them to people at work. With the new Tuya integration, yes, I know it is cloud-based, but it works incredibly well, and I'm actually quite happy to buy Tuya devices personally for my home network. All right.
Tom, not killed any devices yet, though. Don't ask how my brother killed my incredible 10 meg hard drive. Oh, no, please. You must let me know that story. Sounds like a funny one. The TX Ultimate seems to fail to flash as it gets into reboot cycle as my flashing device. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, with flashing, it always seems to be a bit touch and go, I must admit. I have tried many methods for flashing devices. I have got one of the little flashing boards that I got off AliExpress, and I have flashed a few devices. And yes, it is, has been hit and miss. When it works, it's really exciting and fun. When it doesn't work, it can be very, very frustrating. All right. Can't supply enough power to drive the device. Once back on power supply of the device, it's fine. Yeah, this is the problem, is that powering of ESP32s that are permanently connected to the internet, they just chew up the power. It's just phenomenal. I actually bought a little USB power meter recently. I will do a video on it. And that has been really useful because you're able to actually plug things into it and see how much power the device is using. So, yeah, that's a great little device for measuring powering. But if anyone's played with sleep mode in ESP Home, I would be really fascinated to find out how we can put our ESP32 devices into sleep mode so that we can actually create our own battery-powered sensors. So, yeah, please, if anyone knows how to do that, let me know. Otherwise, I will continue my mission to finding that out. All right, Adam's saying here, I have plenty of 18650 batteries. We'll test how long a D1 Mini can last on them. Awesome, Adam. Yeah, please give us feedback on that. I'm not sure how many you're planning to connect because so 18650 battery cells are really cool. I've played around with a lot of them. You can either buy them new, or the other way that you can get them is you can actually go around to places that are recycling laptops and things, and you can actually ask them to give you the battery packs. You can break them open. Now, do be careful. When you start playing with cells and things, they can cause fire. So just make sure you do it outside where you're not going to have any issues. So I have actually disassembled those batteries and I have played around with 18650s. They are a lot of fun. And there's actually a really cool guy that I was following who's actually built his own power walls and all sorts of things. Now, I'm not suggesting you do that, but yeah, you can cause a lot of fires and things, so do be careful. But he's Garcia or something is his name. Just incredible channel. If you're interested in batteries and battery-powered cars and all sorts of things, building your own, Andy Garcia, that's his name. He is a really, really cool guy, and he'll tell you a lot about 18650 cells, although I see lately he's starting to play with LiFePO cells. So, yeah, those are another thing I'd like to start playing with at another stage. But, yeah, power management of sort of DIY ESP32 devices. I think that is another great video, and I will be looking at creating something around that. All right. So going back to our points here. So that's thermostats, smart lighting. Yeah. So personally, most of my lights are running off the Shelly smart switches in the wall. That's working really well. Yes, I do find once in a while one of them will go offline, but most of the time, they are pretty bulletproof. Smart lighting I'm enjoying is things like running WLED to light strips. I put in a new kitchen recently. I've ordered all the components, and I will be putting in a light strip on the underside of my kitchen cupboards, which I'm going to control via WLED. So when I walk into the kitchen in the morning, that comes on a nice dim glow. So that's a cool little project that I'm going to be doing with smart lighting. The other thing I've done is I've put LED, controllable LED strips. I put them behind my TV as sort of a backlight, and that works really well. Smart sensors, wow. When it comes to smart sensors,
this is a huge topic. There are so many different types of sensors available, and I love looking at the data that comes out of my sensors. For example, my weather station, that is just amazing. Watching the changing pressure, changing rainfalls. Sensors to me are one of the most exciting things. I'm currently measuring in my house temperature and humidity in multiple different locations. I'm measuring CO2. That's been a really interesting one. I've got both bought CO2 sensors, but I've got a video explaining how to create your own, building your own sensor. Now, one thing I would recommend, don't buy cheap CO2 sensors because they don't work at all. You need to find the ones that run on the it's an infrared sensor with the infrared light. That's the one that you need to go for because it's really good quality. So with sensors, temperature, humidity, light sensors, I use those as well for controlling things like my curtains and blinds. I'm sensing, what else? Wind speed, barometric pressure. I have just installed a ventilation system into my home. So I am actually looking at ordering a airflow monitor that I actually want to stick into my ventilation system so that I can actually see the air speed or the volume of air that I'm pushing into my house at any one stage. In New Zealand, being a really damp climate, we have a lot of problem with mold and dampness in our houses. So I've installed this system that extracts continually from my bathroom, kitchen, and laundry. And I've got a boost mode on that. So the moment it detects higher humidity, it boosts the system up to full speed automatically without me having to touch a button or anything like that. All right. So those are sensors. And you can talk about sensors forever. Smart cameras. Now, smart cameras, currently there's a lot of discussion. I did a little bit of a question or a poll that I ran on smart cameras recently on my channel, and it was amazing. Out of all the different cameras I put out there, there was one that came, was about 90% votes for it, and that is Reolink. So Reolink, I've got quite an old Reolink camera that's working as my camera facing out into the front of my house. Reolink, they seem to be pretty bulletproof. I've got a Wi-Fi based one. So the Wi-Fi connection seems to be great. Yes, if I speak to my brother, he's always telling me, you could block the Wi-Fi and that would mean that you wouldn't get your signal. But personally for me, Wi-Fi cameras, running cables to your cameras is great, especially if you're running them PoE. So you've got the power and the signal going out to the camera. I think probably on the next camera that I order, I'll looking at ordering a cable-based PoE type camera and trying that out. It means I will need to buy a power over Ethernet hub to power it. But that'll be quite an interesting topic to start playing with powered Ethernet cable cameras. So yeah, Reolink was by far the most popular camera out there for home assistant users. So yeah, based off that, personally, I think I will be looking at getting another one or two Reolink cameras in the near future, playing around with them and seeing what we can do with them. Currently, my camera is storing the information on an SD card, and that's obviously has its moments. SD cards will wear out over time and they're limited. Just a comment here from Adam. I need to replace my Xiaomi cameras. They don't integrate into Home Assistant. Reolinks with solar look good and well-priced. I agree, Adam. The solar, I think, is really awesome. For things like cameras curtains, stuff like that, where you really don't want cables to have to run to your devices, solar power is absolutely awesome. I'm using the SwitchBot curtain openers in my bedroom, and the solar panels, my window faces west, those solar panels are keeping the batteries at 100% power all the time. I never have to worry about plugging them in. So I think solar is really awesome. If the devices can be controlled, powered by solar, and they can store enough energy, recover enough energy from the sun. That is awesome. Some of the cameras I see, the solar panel will keep it topped up, but over time you will actually need to charge it. So interesting to get your feedback, Adam. I'm not sure if you've got a model that you're looking at that you can recommend, but yeah, I think RioLink is a great option, and be really interested to try out new cameras from RioLink. Once again, the next question when it comes to cameras is, how are you actually going to store the data? So are you going to just rely on the SD card for storage, or are you going to buy yourself an NVR recorder that you can actually store in your house and record the information? Now, one of the things around camera storage is that if you're storing it locally, effectively someone that wants to break into your house could actually steal the NVR, take all the data with them, which is a limitation. Similar with the cameras, if they're storing it on a card, they could just rip the camera off and take the card with them. So because of that reason, I do see value in having your camera footage stored on the cloud, because the moment someone comes to your onto your property, that camera footage is stored immediately in the cloud, and whatever they do to your house, even if they burn it down, you've got that camera footage. So that personally for me is the benefit. I'm using my the Ring camera on my front door is giving me a really wide field of view, and that is immediately storing information on anyone that it sees moving in my front garden, and it's pushing that up to the cloud. Yes, I'm paying, I think, about $5 or $6 a month for the Ring storage, but personally for me, I like the camera. Camera streams across to my Amazon devices, integrates really well with Home Assistant, and I am quite happy with paying that that money. All right, Tom is saying, solid line is the average of the four. The weather station currently says it's 10 out of 10 here. Which one to believe? Solid line is the average of the four. The weather station currently says 10 here. Which to believe? Ah, this is talking about pressure. All right, let's see what my pressure is saying at the moment. So my barometric pressure on my sensor outside of my weather station is telling me 10,008.81. I don't have any other barometric pressures to compare that to, but that's what I've got at the moment on mine. See comment above, Tom, can't supply enough power to drive the device. Once back on the power supply, the device is fine. All right. So, yeah, that's what I've got, 1,008. You've got 10 there, Tom. Well, yeah, I'm not sure how good the sensor is inside my weather station. So my weather station was... Repeating, Tom, let's just see what Tom's talking about. Hex data, flash to grid connect bulbs, ESP home. All right. So getting back to cameras and storage. So yeah, for me on cameras, personally, I'm just going to stick with going up. Ah, the next thing I was going to talk about camera, IS is... filtering, as I've included the uni. Oh, he's included the URL. Is it filtering? Sorry, Tom, not quite sure. Here you go. As an example of plotty graph, inaccuracy of aqua temperature. Ah, okay. All right. Now I'm with you, Tom. Sorry. Trying to read back on the stream there. Yeah. So when it comes to devices, as I say, really keen to try out that plotty, and I'm going to give it a go because I love seeing graphs. Now, when it comes to devices, it's very interesting. Now, for temperature humidity, I've been a big fan of these little Xiaomi temperature humidity sensors.
The reason I love them is they are super cheap. Like I'm talking, I can get these for about $5 each if I order them off AliExpress, especially if I buy them in a bundle. And to be honest, the temperature and humidity readings, so for example, if you take a whole lot of them and you put them together and you get some other sensors, I've got some more expensive sensors, they actually perform really well. So I can honestly recommend these. They run on Bluetooth, low energy, and a button cell battery, and they connect really easily. So yeah, thank you for sending me the link to that Plotty. Unfortunately, I can't actually get onto the URL right now, but I will be trying that out and seeing. Now, Aquara temperature, humidity, pressure sensors. I'd be interested to get your feedback, Tom, on what you're thinking of the Aquara sensors. Are those connecting via Zigbee? The reason I'm asking is that my experience with Aquara sensors, I recently bought some door and window Aquara sensors, and what I found is that they are up and down, a little bit dodgy when it comes to connecting to the Zigbee network. And the information that I've read is that with Aquara devices, apparently they're quite fussy about what hub they connect to. So I'm going to play around some more because Aquara devices, they're quite cheap. They seem to be nice quality. But yeah, I'm finding Aquara devices falling off my network quite regularly. So yeah, with regards to the accuracy, I've never tried or tested out Aquara devices for accuracy of their pressure sensors. Everything that I'm referring to is the only pressure sensor that I currently have is the one, it's a weather station that I bought from Bunnings. It was about $300. That is quite expensive, I think. But I have no idea what sort of sensor is inside that or the quality. And I find with sensors, the key thing is if you want to test them out, you really need to find a sensor that is really good quality, place it in the exact location of the sensor you want to test, and run it. Devices falling off my network really to Sonoff USB. Oh, I've got a fly in my room here. Yeah, it is an issue when devices fall off. I think we all hate it. It is an absolute pain. Sonoff USB dongle, yeah. So I've run the Sonoff USB dongle. I was pretty happy with it. I'm now running the Silicon Labs Zigbee dongle, well, Zigbee device that's built into the Home Assistant Yellow. And that one is working well, but I'm also getting battery-based devices falling off. I find that not all of them. So I've got my front door lock is the Yale Assure Zigbee lock. And that one doesn't fall off at all. That is battery powered. That doesn't fall off. So I'm not sure. It's definitely got to do with the devices. And I think that the Aquara devices are very fussy about what hub they use. So if you're really keen on using Aquara devices, it actually might be good to invest in a Aquara Zigbee hub. Install that and see what sort of Zigbee device performance you get. Finding them unavailable is very, very painful. I agree. And you're running it over ZHA. So the other thing that I'm interested to try is Zigbee to MQTT and see whether that improves the performance of the Aquara devices or whether they are still falling off. So that'll be very interesting to do. Yeah, door contact sensor has been tricky to pair. Yeah. So Tom, funny enough for me, it pairs really easily. No problems pairing it. But it falls off. So yeah, very, very frustrating. And we really need to find an answer to this problem of Zigbee devices. I did run a video recently about playing around with Zigbee and looking at the whole Zigbee network. And one of the things it mentioned was trying to connect your Zigbee devices to as close a router as what you can. I think that's something worth having a look at, but definitely Aquara, it's a problem. And if I come across a solution for Aquara, I will definitely be letting you know what the outcome is. So smart door locks, I did mention it. Smart door locks, I've played with two so far. The first one was the Amazon, one I bought on Amazon, and it worked pretty well. Okay, it was an aftermarket one that you bolt on the inside of the door. And the problem I had with it was that it was running off a Wi-Fi connection and it was burning through the batteries. It was using these really specialized sort of small cells. And the cells, especially over COVID time, became incredibly expensive. And because of that, I got really frustrated. So the second lock that I bought and have installed in my latest house is a Yale Assure lock. The Zigbee hub, or the Zigbee little module that you plug in there, is really cool. Basically, you plug it in and it connects to my Zigbee network really well. It doesn't seem to fall off. And yeah, although funny enough, I must say that since the Home Assistant crew has been working lately on updating ZHA, they've got a new system now whereby it actually tests the, it actually allows you to update your Zigbee devices over the ZHA network, which is really cool. I don't think all devices are able to do this as yet, but I think Sonoff is one of the first ones that's going to be implementing this. But yeah, since that, my Zigbee network has been falling over the whole network pretty regularly. So I'm hoping that will come right in the future. Oh, welcome, Tom. New person to the stream here. Are you using the new Aquara T1 door and window sensors, etc.? So let us just have a look at which Aquara sensors I am using. So I can't remember the model number window. Oh, I'll tell you what. I'll go into my AliExpress and I'll be able to tell you immediately which one I ordered. Let's go and have a look at my orders. So the one that I ordered was, let's just scroll down here a little bit. I ordered a lot of stuff on AliExpress. Okay, so Aquara door and window sensors. Doesn't seem to say which model it is here. It just says a door, Aquara door window sensor, Zigbee, wireless connection. Yeah, it doesn't actually say which model this is. I ordered them about 2 months ago, so I'm not sure which one they are. T1 sensor version in a tan box instead of blue and white. No, mine was in the blue and white box as far as I remember. So Robert, please tell me, what is your experience with the Aquara door sensor? Is it working well for you? Which Zigbee hub are you using? And are you using ZHA or MQTT? Please give us a feedback. T1 has improved Zigbee performance. Okay. So yeah, give us some feedback. Are yours falling off at all? And what are your systems that you're using? I use the old small one rather than the new one with the bigger battery option. Okay. So mine are also, oh, awesome. You just got them today, Robert. Well, please give us some feedback. It'd be great to know what your experience is with them. As I say, mine are falling off all over the place. So I need to find a solution. I'm either going to find another type of door and window sensor and switch over, or I need to find some sort of a solution. The T1 is supposed to be better. Yeah. Well, that's very interesting. So please let us know how you get on with that, Robert, because as I say, up to now, mine are falling over and they're not working. Robert, if you can just let me know what network you're on when you give me that feedback, or what type of, to confirm, Zigbee standard. So you're using the ZHA, and what sort of a Zigbee hub have you got? Are you using like the Sonoff stick, or which type of Zigbee network are you using? So yeah, it'd be great to hear that feedback from Robert. However, if I don't get a solution, I am going to be moving away from them and finding another. I'm not sure if anyone else can recommend any types of windows and door sensors. Now, talking about windows and door sensors, I'm going to be doing a video soon on Alarmo. I don't know if anyone's tried Alarmo. The house that I moved in does not have an alarm system. So I'm going to build my own alarm system using sensors, but I need reliable sensors that are not going to fall off the network. So, yeah,
I am going to do a video on Alarmo as I set that up and give you feedback on which sensors I'm connecting to Alarmo and how well they work.
Yeah, they are Zigbee certified. The tricky thing with Zigbee, Robert, and this is the feedback I've got from various people when you're working with Zigbee, is that different providers that are making Zigbee devices do not all communicate with generic hubs. So they might work perfectly with their own hub. For example, Aquara has got a Zigbee hub. It might be worth ordering the Aquara Zigbee hub, linking it up, and actually seeing how it communicates, first of all, with Aquara Zigbee devices, but second of all, with other Zigbee devices. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting. It's a challenge, this whole Zigbee thing. All right, so smart locks, really happy with my Assure. Smart appliances, oh my goodness, don't get me started on smart appliances. I recently bought the Hire dishwasher. It's a beautiful dishwasher, black, fits in with my kitchen, connected up perfectly. The app works great, but you've probably seen there's been a lot of drama about the Aquara, or the Hire integration into Home Assistant. Tom says, sounds like you want to look into the weird world of Zigbee quirks. Oh my goodness. That is exactly what I want to do, Tom. Zigbee, it's a lot of fun to play with. Let's put it this way. It's cool, and it certainly works really well. My experience is that Zigbee works really well with powered devices and with some battery devices. But when it comes, seems to be those small battery, the small devices, and most of them have either been Xiaomi or Aquara, the small button cell battery devices just seem to be a disaster with Zigbee. So there needs to be some sort of a solution, because I'm getting really frustrated with my Zigbee devices falling off. All right, so smart appliances, most of them seem to be run using Tuya. So it will be quite interesting to see with the smart home device, the washing machines, tumble dryers, fridges, etc., that are all being manufactured now with the smart options. It'd be really interesting to see if, with the new Tuya integration, whether they're going to connect to the Smart Life, or the smart devices will connect via Tuya integration and it's going to work better. Let's hope so, because, yeah, don't remind me about Hire. I certainly don't want to go back. There's lots of badly organized custom component YAML files that allow specific Zigbee devices to communicate. Yeah, that is, yeah, it's just constantly challenging, isn't it? This whole Zigbee system, and the fact that different devices are using different Zigbee networks. What I'm very interested to see, and I don't know if you guys have tried any Thread devices as yet. So Thread is very closely linked with Zigbee. So you can even use the same Zigbee radio to communicate with Thread devices. So I'm very interested to see whether the new devices that come out running Thread are going to have the same issues as we're having at the moment with the Zigbee devices. So I haven't yet tried a Thread device. They seem to be really expensive. They come from Eve and companies like this, very expensive, but it will be interesting to see if Thread is going to solve some of the issues that we're having with Zigbee. I often mod blueprints, as the device filter is often has a very specific manufacturer tag. Oh, that's interesting, Tom. Well, it'd be really great to chat in another communication at some stage, Tom, because it would be fascinating to actually see. It sounds like you've got quite an experience with YAML coding, and it'd be really great to see how you're actually modding those Bluetooths. Personally, for me, I'm not a coder, and I find it quite challenging playing around with YAML. I'm learning slowly but surely. I've also tried to play with Node-RED a little bit. Node-RED, I find a little bit more understanding, because it's got a graphical interface and allows you to tinker with it a little bit more easily, but be really good to get to understand how you're actually doing that, Tom, because, yeah, it's a real pain with these new
different appliances that are coming out and not being able to communicate well with them. And yes, you could go in and tinker with them and actually install an ESP32 if you're clever on the hardware side, but you would void your warranties and all sorts of things like that. So this is a big thing. And I'm really hoping with Matter and all of these new things that are trying to tie smart home devices together, it'll be really interesting to see. One thing, one common thread that I am seeing at the moment is devices being manufactured now to communicate with HomeKit, which is in a way pretty cool because I don't really use HomeKit as my main system. I use it as a secondary device connected to my home assistant. But what I do like the idea of is that they do seem to have quite high standards. And if our devices start coming with a HomeKit integration, we can then integrate them to HomeKit and integrate HomeKit with Home Assistant. And hopefully this is going to get us some more robust connections to our devices in the future. So let's look forward to that. All right, smart appliances, entertainment systems. Now, this is something that I haven't done a huge amount with as yet. The guy, Jeff from How To, he has done an awesome video on home automation, controlling your whole home audio system. So yeah, it'd be great to get him on a future live where we can chat to him about that, understand how he's done it, because that is something I would like to do at some stage, installing speakers around my house and controlling them via Home Assistant. So they would be available to have text-to-speech notifications coming in. They can play whole home audio. Yeah, I think it's a great idea. It's something that I really would like to do. The final thing here, we've got smart plugs and outlets. Now, I've never actually installed any smart outlets. I've got quite a few smart plugs. They're a really great way to start playing with home automation. Now that we've got the Tuya integration working with Home Assistant, you can use those smart plugs if you are willing to put up with being on a connection via the internet. All right, lots of I often hear mod blueprints, as the device filter often has a slight manufacturer tag than inspected. Okay, that's interesting. Using mod, all right, yeah. So once again, fascinated to know how you're modding those blueprints, Tom. Please give me some more information. And yeah, it'd be great to connect up and discuss this with you further so that we can do. What I will is I will put my email address into the stream here. And if anyone would like to email me about discussing these things further, it is always a pleasure. Let me just type this in, simoncater@hotmail.com. So feel free, pop me an email and give me some more information on how you're modding those blueprints, because I'm really excited to know. I've got this Hire dishwasher now, which is an amazing product. It works really well, and it will send me notifications on my phone to tell me when the dishes are finished. But yeah, I would really like to get it properly integrated into Home Assistant if I can. Another message from Tom. My simple four-button scene switch from Mohs has a tag of TZ3000, a blueprint investigating the device. Interesting. So Mohs, I got a device from Mohs the other day. Was it Mohs? No, that was Moo Moo Buzz. Sorry, I'm getting confused here. That's for the manufacturer, not the Mac. Okay. Yeah, this is getting pretty technical, and yeah, I would really like to know how you're doing this, Tom. So please, yeah, drop me an email and let me know exactly how you're actually modding the hex, the file, because yeah, I'm not a YAML expert. I don't think I'll ever get there. I like playing with Home Assistant, but YAML is just the next level. All right. So let's just see if there's anything else in the notes that I had put together for today's stream. Okay, room by room. All right, concealing of wires and devices. Now, this is an interesting one. So
When it comes to devices and smart homes, I'm sure most of us will agree you don't really want your home looking like some big science experiment with wires everywhere. So yeah, it's really cool to be able to use devices that offer you options where you don't have to do wiring. This is why I like, for example, cameras that have got solar panels that are powering them continually. You don't have to worry about wiring. You don't have to worry about it at all. So it's going to be interesting to see how these devices start changing over the years and moving forward and becoming more and more user-friendly. And when it comes to concealing of wires and devices, yeah, one of the things that is pretty cool with millimeter wave technology, you can actually create a sensor and you can install it inside your, from the top down, if you've got access to your ceiling, you can actually install a millimeter wave presence sensor inside the roof cavity, and that will then, the millimeter wave will go straight through the ceiling board and it will actually sense people moving around in the room below. So that is pretty cool because that means you don't actually have a physical device sitting on the counter or on the wall that you have to worry about. You can actually hide these things away. So there's lots of ways that you can do it. Now, unfortunately, when you do away with cables and you go Wi-Fi, you do actually have the possibility the device is going to fall off. And this is a very interesting one because, for example, if you are planning a smart home from scratch and you are moving into a new house, you would actually be able to pre-wire everything. And this would be absolutely awesome. The one limitation of it is that I'm not actually seeing many devices, well, devices you can buy from the shop, that are cost-effective and will allow you to run wired, for example, controlling lights and things. The moment you get to the wired stuff, it seems to get really expensive. So it'd be interesting to know. Here's another comment here from Tom. My electrician suggested getting IP67 power supplies, hiding them under the house. They're running 24 volts, so the voltage drop isn't too bad. Tom, I agree totally. Having a 24 or even 12 volt device for any outdoor lighting is absolutely awesome. In my previous house, I did a lot of outdoor wires for smart lighting and it worked really, really cool. I effectively just had a little a relay, which was controlled by an ESP32, and that would then run to 12 volt cables throughout my garden connected to low voltage 12 volt LED systems in the garden. And it worked really, really well. The beauty of that is you don't have AC 220 volts running in your garden. You don't have to worry about water affecting it. It is a totally awesome idea, Tom. I agree with you. Install one of those power supplies under your house and you can literally just run any cables without having a hassle. A friend of mine did that as well. And yeah, electricians seem to be really good at offering that as an option. Now, getting back to cabled versus wired versus wireless. So, yeah, a lot of people have asked me that question. If they're starting up a smart home and they're going to be pre-wiring it, I'm just not seeing many devices on the market. And I'm talking about, you know, sort of the cheap stuff that we're buying as DIY for pre-wired. So, yeah, if anyone's got any ideas about pre-wiring a house, a brand new house, pre-wiring for smart lighting and things like that, let me know if you've found any devices that are quickly or easily available and cost-effective to be able to go with a wired connection. Therefore, you're not worried about devices falling off. Anyway, guys, I must call this to an end. Unfortunately, my voice is getting a bit dry and gruff here. It's been really great having you guys on the stream again. I will be running future streams in the future, and I will be running one with Jeff from How To at one stage, which is going to be really awesome. We'll be doing some live stuff of actually setting up Home Assistant from scratch. I'm sure that'll go down really well. But anyway, guys, thank you so much once again for joining me on the stream today.
look forward to seeing you all again in a live stream coming up soon. That's all for now. Bye then.